never found them that difficult myself personally.
Lots of people didn't.
I think people in the record business think that we are a bit awkward.
I mean, maybe people think that they're awkward because, you know, there is seven of them and they all participate in the decision-making processes.
Because Chumbas have been around a long, long, long time, they almost could forget what each other was thinking.
They were, you know, fairly adamant about doing things their way and not particularly willing to make big compromises.
We're only awkward artistically and politically. We're not really awkward as people at all. We're really polite with everyone.
I just think we're the most easygoing pushovers that you've ever met, really.
One person was in charge of this, one person was in charge of that, Alice was in charge of everything.
Record companies don't like it when you say, no, I don't want a video with We Are Ballerina in it. Or like, no, I don't want, you know, I don't want a video with Keith Allen in it.
It is the music business. It's not just music. There is a business part of it as well. And the band, you know, absolutely should participate in that, and they did. And so we welcome that, and that was great.
So they'd never trust the record company?
No.
There's no element of trust?
Well, there was no element of trust, and there was almost always an element of suspicion.
To me, they were anything but awkward. They were actually really interesting and really inspiring.
Yeah, of course I found them difficult, yeah. They were difficult. They were difficult. But I still like them nevertheless.
Yeah, we have managed to keep doing things our way, but at the same time, it does mean we shoot ourselves in the foot a lot. But I suppose it's why we've continued to exist. And looking back, I mean, there's loads of embarrassing moments. You look at videos and you just think, oh, no. Too much, you're down on your passion or down on your luck. Sometimes questions never get dropped. Are you big? Are you dancing?
We were totally useless at running our own business and having a band at the same time. We just couldn't do the two things. One suffered because of the other, and we just thought, this is stupid. And also, when we signed to One Little Indian, we'd reached a point where we thought, we've got to move on from where we were.
They wanted the comfort and expenditure that a bigger record label could give them, but they didn't want to have any... the record company weren't allowed any input into it. You know, they wouldn't want to be marketed as this or that or the other. It was almost as if they were above that, but they weren't above having the spend on a full-page ad for their album. You know, you didn't really have anything to do with Chumbas other than just give them the money and get their records in shops.
Chumbawamba in particular, I just think are so unutterably ridiculous. I'm amazed anybody takes them at all seriously.
You know, it's just awful, half-sampled, jumpy, shouty tragedy.
They're the collection of ludicrous, elderly anarchist bores who've been banging on since shortly after the Peasants' Revolt about how if only everybody would listen to what they were saying and buy their records, then we would bring down the global capitalist system.
Bands like Chumbawamba and that are a bit daft, really. It's like they spent the past 3 years moaning about the Labour government and attacking John Prescott with water. During 19 years of Margaret Thatcher, they failed to do anything significant about that.
Most music journalists tend to be white, male, middle class and rather boring, and they tend to like white, male, middle class and rather boring musicians.
In a way, much though I despise Chumbawamba, I despise them for their music. And not
because of the music?
Terrible band.
They never had an easy time with anybody in the press, that's for sure.
I'm not in the habit of slagging off bands because they lack an image, popularity and any sign of talent. I think care in the community should be supported. So let's give Chumbawamba a nice, polite round of applause for doing so well. Well done, Chumbawamba. Now sod off.
They were one of those bands that, you know, the Enemy would never write about or any of the other music press, but there would be 1,000 kids at every gig. They could go out and do 10 shows in England pretty much any time, and they would sell out. Yet there's some band on the cover of the Enemy who can't sell out the Hope and Anchor.
I'll drink a lager drink, I'll drink a cider drink, several probably, and this'll still sound like naive political posturing from a bunch of soft middle-class student twats. It's a 20-track best of from Norbert No Bacon and his tub-thumping tosspot pals.
I don't know, really. I mean, it quite amazes me how sort of, how worked up they can get about us. Do you know what I mean? It's like, God. Is this just, you know, can you really work yourself up in such a lather about us? Like, we're just a band.
For the past 13 years, this band have inflicted oral torture on the... You can't write that. For the past 13 years, this band have inflicted oral torture on the innocent listening public absolutely relentlessly. Forget revolution, a decent tune would be nice. Everyone should buy this album just to remind themselves that there is music this bad out there. That's fantastic.
All of the media, the radio and television, all want to feel that they have participated in the success of, you know, a band or an artist. And they want to feel that without, you know, us having put them on the cover or without us having done that article, you know, no one ever would have known.
You know, they say one thing and they do another and they make appalling music.
Yeah, they're not very good pop stars and they're not very good political activists either.
Rubbish, of course, but almost worth stealing for the sleeve booklet. 8 pages of band history which, for sheer woolly-mindedness, pious self-justification and a bull-headed refusal to look truth in the face beats anything you'll find outside the covers of Thatcher, the Downing Street years. Chumbawamba are a one-legged man at an arse-kicking party.
We don't fit in with whatever's flavour of the month, which is what all them papers do. They're all about flavour of the month and they're all about product placement.
The music press didn't view them as sexy. You know, it was, oh, it's political. You know, they're banging on about politics.
You know, if some jerk from Enemy doesn't get it, doesn't, I don't lose any sleep over it, basically.
People in Germany and, you know, Austria, France, wherever, it were like, at least they understood what we were trying to do, you know, and they had a bit of respect for it. They might not have liked the record, but, you know, at least they were like, well, yeah, they're an interesting band, this lot. You know, they're not like all the other bands. Whereas in, you know, UK, we just get totally slagged.
Cool to see the Scumbawamba backlash at last. Mind you, I've always called them arrogant, sloganeering, fucking sellout ride on the bandwagon of gay rights, liberal chanting, shit music, playing good for nothing except laughing at fucking corporate whores. Know what I'm saying? And you can fucking print that too. Just make sure you credit it to me. I'm making my position clear on this. That's Russell from Hull.
Maybe in about 10 years' time, when kids are about 21 that are writing for the Enemy or something and remember something or something that they jumped around to at school discos, maybe they'll be forgiven then.
What is it that they're not forgiven for, just being political or not?
Yeah, for being too clever. The Chumbawambas are too intelligent for the press, for the music press.
Call it, 'cause you must go shit. Call it, 'cause you must go shit. Do something about it.
Do something about it.